Last week, I taught a message on how God responds. Starting off with laying a foundation that God is love, and then taking a look in the Old Testament how God responds to us, and then looked in the New Testament how God responds to those who are hurting or who think they've messed up or who are unapproachable and unacceptable. And we discovered that God runs to them. He goes for people that are walking through difficulties. And that's really exciting. If we start to see the pattern, maybe we'll start to believe it. Maybe we'll start to see this God we say we believe in is actually good. Because we don't use the word good often. We probably say, oh, he's loving, he's, you know, he's powerful, and oh, in awe and worship, and we have those terms. But do you know he is good? And he's for you? I know a lot of you do, but we can forget, especially when we're blindsided with issues. Then our emotions, our feelings, do not trust what we know in our heads. And if we don't know the difference, we're going to gravitate to our emotional truth instead of true truth. I'm begging you, don't do that. Most of your problems come from living out of an emotional truth that does not reflect true truth. They can, but many times they don't. Especially when we're walking in fear, when we're afraid, when we have a crisis hit us. Well, we're going to face crisis all the time. Welcome to this world. Don't be surprised. Oh, I think Jesus said that. Yes. Yeah. He said, don't be surprised when these trials come. Don't be surprised when the crap hits the fan. Don't be surprised. I'm there. I'm loving on you. So today, after this message is over, I realized, I forgot my best part. So I'm going to continue today, and I want to get into something really, really cool. I've touched on this before, but I want to zoom in on it now because this is like the crescendo of what God does in response to us. So if you have your Bibles, don't open them because I'm going to read it from the Message. What pastor does that? Don't open your Bibles. You can open your Bibles to Luke chapter 15 if you want to. But I'm going to encourage you just to listen. I want you to listen to this story. It comes from the Message translation. The story of the lost son. Then he said, there once was a man who had two sons. The younger said to his father, Father, I want right now what's coming to me. He didn't do that. If we had the video, they might see that. But anyway. So the father divided the property between them. And it wasn't long before the younger son packed his bags and left for a distant country. There, undisciplined and unruly, he wasted everything he had. After he had gone through all his money, there was a bad famine all through the country, and he began to hurt. He signed on with a citizen there who assigned him to his fields to slop the pigs. He was so hungry. He would have eaten the corn cobs in the pig slop, but no one would give him any. That brought him to his senses. He said, all those farmhands working for my father sit down to three meals a day, and here I'm starving to death. Is that funny? Sorry. I'm going back to my father. I'll say to him, let me think. Father, I've sinned against God. I've sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son. Take me on as a hired hand. He got right up and went home to his father. When he was still a long way off, his father saw him. His heart pounded, and he ran out, embracing him and kissed him. The son started his speech. Father, I've sinned against God. I've sinned before you. I don't deserve to be called your son ever again. But the father wasn't listening. He was calling to his servants, quick, bring a clean set of clothes and dress him. Put the family ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Then get a grain-fed heifer and roast it. We're going to feast. We're going to have a wonderful time. My son is here. Given up for dead and now alive. Given up for lost, now found. And they began to have a wonderful time. All this time, the older brother was out in the field. When the day's work was done, he came in, and as he approached the house, he heard music and dancing. Calling over to one of the houseboys, he asked, "What is going on?" He told him, "Your brother came home. Your father's ordered a feast, barbecue beef, because he has him home safe and sound." The older brother stalked off in an angry sulk and refused to join in. His father came out and tried to talk to him, but he wouldn't listen. The son said, "Look, how many years have I stayed here serving you, never giving you one moment of grief, but you have never, ever thrown a party for me and my friends. This son of yours, who has thrown away your money on whores, shows up, and you go out on an all-out feast?" His father said, "Son, you don't understand. You're with me all the time, and everything that is mine is yours. But this is a wonderful time. We had to celebrate. This brother of yours was dead. He's alive. He was lost, and now is found." One of the most powerful and popular parables in the Bible. Well known. Usually it's called the prodigal son. The word prodigal means wasteful. This story has far more reaching implications than you think. And I want you to hear some of them. Some of the points that I want to zoom in on. The boy's inheritance is not due until his father dies. Did you catch that part? But he wants it now. Now, you could say the father was a bit naive and a wuss because he caved in and gave it. You could say he was an irresponsible father. Remember, it's a parable, okay? You could say that. And yet, there was one common theme running through this whole story, and that is agape. Agape is the Greek word for love. Other-centered love. We're going to finish today with that text. But agape was flowing from the father the whole time. He didn't argue, at least not in the story, because Jesus is making a point in telling the story. Agape's flowing. So he gives him the money. Off he goes. In one way, you could even take the request as saying, "Dad, I wish you were dead. Please give me my money now." That is another way to take it. None of us ever feel like that about our parents, do we? Some really don't. Some, you'd be surprised. Given the grief of relationships, there are stresses. And it may be a temporary thought that was planted. It never came from your true spirit. The father does not deny the request and he has no objections. He's not reckless. He is purely loving the whole time. Here's what the father knows. The money will run out. Always does. Right? How many of you have limitless money? It runs out. Okay? It's going to happen. So he knows the money runs out. His newfound friends will desert him. When you have money, you have new friends. And they're never real. They want something, which is the opposite of agape. The son will be so degraded that he will gladly do for a stranger what he would not do for his own father. He comes to a place of utter brokenness. Did you ever pray for somebody or think, how low can they go? How much can they handle? Why can't they learn? Good question. And we have many friends like that, don't we? We all can think of somebody in our lives, it's like, we're either embarrassed by them, or we even have abandoned them sometimes, given up on them. Agape doesn't. And this son went away, squandered everything, and became so low to the point where he realized Something deep inside was prompting him. The deep inside bottom truth that couldn't be found until everything else, all independence, was removed. The truth was he had a father. He had resources back home. He knew his father was good. He forgot. But the crisis, the crap, made it come alive for him. There are people walking through a lot of difficult things. And I believe, hear this carefully. I do not believe the mentality that God will do this to you in order so you can come to brokenness and suffer. He's going to just do it with that kind of a coldness. Do you understand? I don't believe that. I believe Papa lets things happen to us on purpose. He knows, and it's all controlled. You don't think it is, but it's controlled love to bring you to a place of brokenness where you're not self-sufficient anymore. You're dependent on him. So you come to the core and only truth you possibly know. I have a father. A heavenly father. All I know is Jesus. That may be all that you ever come to. In fact, you may even scream out the terms, I don't even know if I believe in God anymore or Jesus. And that's okay. That's scary for parents to hear when their kids are screaming that. I'll tell you. Not easy. It's scary for a spouse when their other spouse says, I give up, I don't believe anymore. Those things are scary. Folks, the one who says that is on their own journey. Don't be the one who steps in to try and help. Let the Holy Spirit do it, even though you love. This father let his son go. Did you kind of notice that he was waiting? A long way off. Here he comes. I want to read to you from one of Paul Anderson Walsh's books. I forget which one it is. Here's what he writes about the story. Perhaps more than any other story in the New Testament, the story of the prodigal son illustrates how this agape love flows both towards us and from us. Listen carefully to this. The prodigal son is a well-known story. It is a play in three parts about two prodigal sons endeavoring with varying degrees of success to reconcile themselves to the absurdity of their father's agape love for them. The word prodigal means wasteful, and in this parable, both boys squandered their inheritance. One in the form of license, the other in the form of legalism. Both did it because they perceived themselves to be slaves and not sons. Remember, the older son was working in the fields. Interesting. However, at the end of the parable, we have the younger and wasteful son restored and reconciled, having passed from death to life. And in contrast, his elder brother is depicted as estranged and unable to reconcile himself to his father's love for his brother, and consequently is alienated from the family of which he is fully a part of. Isn't that cool? By self-righteous pride, which has driven him to be apart, the curtain comes down on the parable with the elder brother trapped in a self-imposed hell with the father present with him in it, beseeching, inviting, and loving his elder son back to life. You ever see that before? This is so cool. It is a startling thought that the one who comes to his senses is the one who, from a religious perspective, is irredeemable. Both the sons see their father as a slave driver for whom they work rather than a senior partner in a business which they will one day inherit. Wow. Final quote. The story of the prodigal son is fundamentally a story about the perpetual acceptance of agape, in whose loving arms both the boys are wrapped. At first brush, it seems to be about forgiveness, but it is not. It is about a father whose two sons think they're slaves. What are you? You sons, daughters, or you slaves? You better know the truth. You're sons and daughters. Stop living like slaves. Stop judging one another. We see the prodigal son, the one who took off, you know, he's the bad one, and the other one was the okay, you know, one. He did less bad stuff. What? This is not about forgiveness. This is about the loving father accepting both of their boys, and they had to come to a place where they believed their acceptance. The one became more teachable because of his circumstances. The other one, don't know where he's at. But he's with his dad, being loved. The elder brother could have some questions. Here's some of the questions he could have with the father, running conversation. Are you saying that as a son I am free to do whatever I want? The father says, yes. Okay, but if I do, I will have to take what's coming, right? Yep, that's right. Okay, good. But just so we're clear, what's coming is punishment, right? No, that's wrong. But surely I will be punished for my sins. No, you will not be punished for your sins. That's absurd. Why ever not? Because there's no condemnation for you. To start with, there's no law. And where there's no law, there's no violation. I have already died for your sins. So, what you're saying is that we are lawless? No. What I'm saying is you are law-free. So, does that mean that sin doesn't matter? No, it matters for two reasons. We don't get punished for sin. We get punished by it, as do all those who are impacted by us. You see the focus? I used to be very sin conscious, preaching against behaviors. Stop doing this, stop doing that. You know, do this, do that. Don't need to. I'm just going to point you to Jesus, teach you to listen to him. That's all I got. That's a powerful picture. Listen to this quote. A lot of quotes today, but it's so good. I can't. I'm not that smart. So I have to find it. We will never stand trial in the mind of God concerning our faithfulness to him. Let me say that again. We will never stand trial in the mind of God concerning our faithfulness to him. However, when we live in the self-reliant realm, God will often stand trial in our minds as to whether or not he is faithful towards us. He is going to convict your minds that he is faithful. It's not about your faithfulness. It's about his. And it's good news. He is your faith. He is your belief. He is your life. He's done it all. So what are you trying to help him out with? Can you just bask and rest in his love? Is that hard to do? Yes, it is, because emotionally, many of us do not believe we're lovable. We're not good enough to be that acceptable. We might have a smidgen of it, but that couple of those closets, whoa, those are just unlovable parts. Wrong. It may take you the rest of your life to discover you are fully and completely lovable. Acceptable. Sorry about the front row there. Folks, how else does God respond to us? First of all, he runs towards us. Secondly, John 7:37. Says, anyone who's thirsty, come. I've got the water for you. People are asking. They may not have words for the questions. So Jesus actually forms the questions for them and puts it in their minds, and they think of it and they think they self-did it, but it really was Jesus. Matthew 11:28, those who are weary and heavy burden, come to me and you will find more work to do. You're going to find rest. Rest has a name. His name is Jesus. Is this how we sell God to the world. This is the Jesus they need to hear about, that he's an all-accepting, loving God. Don't you worry about all the other questions they have, like, well, does that mean I can do whatever I want, all that stuff? Will you quit trying to play God? Don't you think their questions for them, okay? That's what gets us in trouble. Just point them to Jesus and love them. And if you don't know you're fully loved, fully acceptable in every category, every department, every closet in yourself, you're going to have a hard time doing that for others. I was telling somebody this morning that when we come into discovering who grace really is, first of all, slows everything down, almost to a screeching halt. And some of us, reverse, now we got to go back. Oh, crap. Unlearn all this stuff and rediscover. It takes a long time. And it's okay. You can't hurry grace. Matthew 19, verse 14 says, let the little children come to me. Let them come. In fact, if you can't believe like a child, you're not going to get it. That's why doctrine will never save you. It's too complicated. Way too complicated. In fact, it causes so many divisions, it's not even funny. Does it have value? Yes. But the simple gospel comes first. If you don't understand anything else after that, fine. You don't need to. I believe Jesus Christ is my life. Period. What that looks like for me is my journey. You are all on your own journeys. Oh, and then we happen to have a collective connection. So that's kind of nice. And we can share our journeys and learn from each other and discover and go, whoa, I never saw that part of God before. Is that how you saw that? I never would have seen that. Do you hear my story? You know, and then on you, it's amazing. 1 Corinthians 13. The word love in this passage is agape. There are four words in the Greek for the word love. Storge, which is a parental love. Phileo fish, which is a friendship love. Then there's eros, erotic, and agape. God is described as agape. He is agape. And so when we read love is patient, love is kind, God is patient, God is kind. Your papa is patient, your papa is kind. Agape is. In weddings, we read them and now do this kind of love to one another. What? Did you say do that kind of love? You guys can't. I can't. It's not the to-do list. Somebody lied to us for a long time. That is a picture of what love looks like. And here's what's going to happen. When you start to believe it, it's actually going to start to radiate from your life. You're going to see the evidence of God start to spill out of you onto others. His kindness, his goodness, his patience, his kindness is flowing out. He's the source. That's good news. Let me give you a final interpretation of that text. Agape is always patient, meaning not withholding anger, but without anger, totally understanding, knowing the end from the beginning. It's unbelievably patient, never punishing others, either physically or emotionally, for wrongs suffered. Agape is always kind, meaning others-centered, always thinking of the good in others. Can I bless you versus how can you bless me? Agape is never jealous, meaning agape is jealous for us and never jealous of us. Big difference. Agape is never boastful or arrogant, meaning never seeks to self-exalt, always promotes others. Agape never acts unbecomingly, meaning is always modest, always graceful, always moving in humility. Agape seeks not its own, meaning it has no concept of self-getting. This is the Trinity, folks. And you've been invited into that love. Agape is never provoked, hopes for all things, endures all things, and never fails. Meaning, It's not touchy or ill-tempered. Ooh, don't do that. God might get a little ticked off. Oh, I'm starting to tick him off. I know it. No. You can't. You can't tick him off. I believe it is an impossibility. He only has love for you. And he can't stop. It's a gushing well. And he's saying, come drink from me. And all you're going to get is love, love, love. It's almost like a Beatles song. Sorry. Love. It sounds so simple. This closing video with the lights off is a powerful story from a long time ago that I listened to as a teenager. But the song's powerful. Some of you saw it on my Facebook page. Originally written by a guy named Benny Hester, When God Ran.
I feel the presence of the Lord moving still. There's a song that we sang many years ago. I don't even know, where did you find this song?
Well, this song actually was recorded many years ago by a young man named Benny Hester. And I begged these guys to do this song for two or three albums. And like knuckleheads, they wouldn't listen to me. But this song has a tremendous, powerful message. And I've known people that thought somehow they had walked beyond God's grace. It's a wonderful thing to know that he reaches us no matter where we go, and his love reaches for us. His hand is extended. And I want you to listen to the words of this song tonight. If you maybe walked into this building and feel a long ways from your Heavenly Father.
Almighty God, the great I am, immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run was when he ran to me. He took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, by surprise, when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart. And I wondered then if things could ever be the same. Then one night, and he brought me to my knees when God ran. I saw him run to me. I was so ashamed
That's the response I expect from all of you. Guys, what'd you think? Did you hear it? Did you hear the love? There's one more thing about that story that I didn't know. In that culture, when you shame your father so badly, you were to be stoned to death right away if they ever saw you again. So that father running. Protecting. Shielding his son. That is God to you right now. And don't you ever forget it. Don't ever question it. You know what? You can question it all you want. That's okay. He can handle it. But I'm telling you, it's true. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for running to me. Thank you for your faithfulness my whole life. Even when I acted faithless, even when I felt I had none, you were my faith, even though I didn't feel I had any. Thank you. I pray today, each one here will take something away that you tell them about this. Speak truth into our minds. Renew our minds to believe what you think about us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.